Direct from Las Vegas, the Auto Channel presents press pass coverage of the 2008 Alternative Fuels and Vehicles National Conference and Expo.
Now it's pretty clear why Google's one of our award winners today, because you guys are doing amazing things. One of the first questions people always ask me is, Google's doing what? So you gave us a great picture.
There is no G car.
There is no G car? We need our sound to be hot on the table, please. Thank you. We have a microphone there. If you're not very loud or you're feeling a little tired, your voice is a little quiet, you can speak there, ask questions. Yes, sir.
Joel Poynton, I'm with the San Diego Gas and Electric and manage the electric transportation program. We have a similar demonstration project we've been performing with two high motion vehicles and seeing very similar type of results. One of the challenges we have in communicating this to the consumer is exactly what you demonstrated there, that short vehicle experiences can be well over 100 miles per gallon equivalent. But if you're looking at the overall performance of the vehicle, you're seeing something such as you showed with the cumulative history of the vehicle, something in the 60s, basically. About a 40 to 50% increase over the overall mileage for the average Prius. Our challenge, and I'm wondering what you've thought about in trying to bring that distinction forward to the public to help them understand both what this demonstration project means. We have a vehicle that was designed as a hybrid. We're trying to make it perform as a plug-in hybrid, which it was not designed to do from the beginning. And we're working with prototype battery installations that are still in the developmental stages. So we have an imperfect model that we're using to demonstrate the viability of plug-in hybrid technology. But we need to help the consumer frame what these results mean. And also, after that, I just want to make one comment about the comment you made about utilities and the OEMs working together.
So I think you said part of, well, hot mic. I think you said a lot about a lot of things that we agree with. I think we had on a slide back there that architecture really matters. And so, you know, these vehicles, as you said, are a first generation or even a generation 0.5 vehicles. They were designed as hybrids and they've sort of had a plug-in hybrid pack, you know, wedged into them. Not saying that that High Motion and some of the other companies that have worked on these conversions haven't done a good job in making the systems work. They have, but it's really key to understand that they're not designed from the ground up. And it's clear that if they are designed from the ground up, people are going to be able to make vehicles that do get over 100 miles per gallon consistently. The number one problem that I think we have with this is that these cars are designed to heat up the catalyst and the pollution trap by turning the engine on and get really, and in the course of doing that, they get really crummy gas mileage. They get about 35 miles per gallon for the first 3 or 4 minutes, and unfortunately, over two-thirds of our trips in our particular fleet application are 3 or 4 minutes long. And most of the time that they go on those short little trips, they're not, they've been sitting for a while, so they're cold. So those are cold starts. They're not warm already. So we're really looking forward to getting, you know, there's several manufacturers have talked about getting plug-in hybrids out there on the market. People are trying blended strategies, they're trying strategies that have true all-electric range, there are serial hybrids, there are parallel hybrids. We really want to be a center for sort of aggregating all that data and showing people the differences, because I think when people understand, you know, you can do a plug-in hybrid this way and get 65 miles per gallon, and you can do it this way and get, you know, 150, that's going to make a big difference in which vehicle they choose to have. So I totally agree with you that it's a big challenge to get that message across. As Adam mentioned, because the driving cycle we've had in our G fleet is not representative of sort of the standard U.S. average, we're just starting this research effort to actually drive some of our vehicles and try to follow the U.S. NPTS data very closely and see what results we get then. But even then, I expect that we'll get slightly better results in that case. It's important to know that the cars that we have are not at all optimized. And so we look forward to getting those cars in the future in the next couple of years that are optimized and running them through the same set of tests. And I expect to see in the next, you know, half decade to decade great improvements.
That could be a pretty compelling case for them.
Well, one thing I did want to mention, the California Electric Transportation Coalition is a group of the five major utilities in California, and we are working very closely with the OEMs at this point. We're also, SDG&E in particular, will have completed its smart metering installation by 2011. And the EPRI Infrastructure Working Council, which is a cross-section of utilities from across the United States, and more than six of the OEMs are working together right now on standardization for connectors and communications for plug-in hybrids. And we extend an invitation to anyone else that would be interested in participating in that. Thank you.
Yeah, let's talk to you after the show.
Our next question, I think, was this gentleman, and then Lee, go after him. You guys can line up at the microphone or do something more creative than I can think of if you want to.
Mahi Reddy, I'm from SemaConnect, and my question relates to consumer behavior and, you know, its potential for perhaps, you know, destabilizing this movement to EVs and PHEVs. One of the things, I mean, when in your presentation that kind of came up was the fact that, you know, every time you drive and you come back and you stop, you have to actually plug the car back into the grid. And I wonder if you've done any studies on, you know, how, you know, I mean, how motivated are people to actually do this? Because my understanding is that, you know, if you're going to fill gas once a week, that's okay, you can put up with that. But if you're expected every time you pull up at work, every time you go home to, mm-hmm. you know, haul the cable out of the trunk, plug it in, mm-hmm. It's just a very significant issue. And I had a follow-up question, which is, if I may, I'll go through that as well, sure. Which is, you know, so we've, you know, my company is one of the, you know, as a startup, and we've actually designed a robotic system that automates this process. In effect, this system will communicate with the car. When it pulls up, it automatically plugs itself in and recharges and, you know, meters the electricity and so on. So do you have any template for companies such as mine to participate in your research? You know, you've got these 10 Priuses. You know, is there any template that we can also be part of that research effort? Thank you.
So let me answer the first question first. Plugging in isn't very difficult, especially I think we had a slide, or maybe we took it out in there, but we, under those solar charge ports, we actually have plugs that hang down from the ceiling on reels, and it takes about maybe 5 seconds to plug in. Also, the drivers know that we're recording all the data about both driving and charging, so if they didn't plug in and charge the cars a lot, we would be able to know it and you know, tell which individual drivers weren't doing a good job, although not that we're really policing it that way. So I think most people are pretty good about plugging it in. What they're not good about, if I guess the point we were trying to get across there, if it's not their own personal car, is actually plugging it in and then like waiting a second, making sure that it is charging, or, you know, sometimes if a circuit breaker tripped or something, it making sure that it's really working right. Like, they're willing to take the time to plug the plug in, but kind of check and make sure it's working right. They're maybe not so willing to take the time. Part of that is vehicle design issue. Again, these are prototype cars, and you need to have the cars designed in a way that they're just dead simple. It doesn't fail. It always works when you plug it in. So I don't really think that the plugging in part is that hard to do, and it really has a lot of advantages versus visiting a gas station. If you have to visit a gas station half as often as you would normally, and the trade-off for that is that every day you have somewhere between 10 and 30 seconds of fiddling with the plug, it seems like it's a pretty good trade-off. But that said, mechanisms to make it even easier are welcome. And if somebody, I've seen a lot of attempts at doing automated inductive charging. I've heard of attempts, I'm not sure if this is, if you're talking about an automated conductive charging.
It's conductive.
Yeah. I've heard about that. I haven't seen anything like that in person. So far, nobody's really come up with the secret sauce that's made that more trouble, or more worth more than the trouble to put all that equipment in and the extra cost and stuff. But if you can come up with a really low-cost solution that really makes that work, I think that just makes it even more, makes the problem of plugging in even less of a problem. But I guess I just want to make clear, I don't think that the plugging in part is really much of a problem in the first place compared to the alternative.
Also, tracking is an issue because, if when people go to work and if you're plugging it in there, who pays for that electricity? If I go to a mall and plug it in, who's paying for that?
That's a much bigger issue. Actually, plugging the plug-in isn't that hard, but the whole issue of the mobility of a vehicle, especially if you're talking about in a vehicle-to-grid situation, like Anna mentioned, whether it's just controlling the vehicles for demand response, which once we have tens and hundreds of thousands and millions of these cars out there, you're going to have to do so that they don't all charge on a hot summer day. Whether it's that or whether it's actually doing bidirectional V2G, you need a way to track things in order to turn them on and off, but you also need to know how to bill, who to bill, where to send the bill to, what the rates are. What if somebody goes from, Southern California Edison to the San Diego utility area, which happens quite a bit. There's a lot of people that live close to one city and commute to the other back and forth. So there's a lot of work that needs to be done there. I totally agree.
The one other thing, too, is that UC Davis is actually conducting some research now on driving behavior of individuals, so that might actually capture some of that willingness to charge information.
Thanks.
Just one footnote on the consumer behavior, and that is, folks, I think we tend to underestimate the ability of people to change when they have some kind of motivation to do it. When they have some skin in the game and it's their vehicle and they see an obvious benefit for having a plug-in, that motivates them. Folks don't have any trouble going home at night and plugging in their cell phone. And I think it's just, if you look at the psychology and just the way people's habit behavior works, it takes about 21 days to establish a habit, and after having a new vehicle, a plug-in vehicle, for a couple of weeks, it really is. I personally don't believe that that's going to be a big issue for most consumers, and it may even become kind of a part of their ritual, like brushing their teeth or charging the cell phone. It's really not a big deal.
Yeah. One thing, we kind of alluded to it, but in the first month when we had these cars, we had a limited subset of people driving them for longer periods of time, and it was more like it was our vehicle. And I was routinely getting over 80 miles per gallon in the car when I was driving the car, and I wasn't trying to optimize for mileage when I was driving. I was being very careful to drive as I normally drive my normal car. So it really does matter, like Ralph said, if you have some skin in the game, if it's your own car or a car that feels like your own car, then you make sure that you plug in right and all that kind of stuff.
Rolf, you just gave me a great idea. We need cell phones that automatically plug themselves in.
I think
not because it's too much trouble, but because I forget.
Yeah.
Lee.
Lee Grannis, Greater New Haven, Clean Cities Coalition, New Haven, Connecticut. I've got some questions about the battery technology. How many kilowatt hours are you carrying on there, batteries?
So the high motion system uses a second battery. They leave the Toyota battery in place, which is about a 1.2 kilowatt hour battery that's only using, 300 to 500 watt hours. They limit it to the middle range for lifetime purposes. So, and high motion is adding approximately five kilowatt hour battery. It's iron phosphate A123 technology, and that has a pretty good cycle life, so they're able to drain that down somewhere around between 5% and 10% state of charge before they stop. So they're using about 4 to 4.5 kilowatt hours of the 5 kilowatt hours available.
And that gets them how many miles on the battery pack?
Typically what we see is, remember that the Prius operates in a blended mode all the time. So unless you You can sometimes keep it in all-electric mode if you drive it very slowly below 35 miles per hour, which hardly anybody does. And I make a point of not trying to drive it that way. I just drive it normally. So if it was driving, if you could drive it in all EV mode, that battery would probably get you some that amount of battery would get you about 15, 16 miles of range. What we're typically seeing is that battery drains from 0 to about 7% when it cuts off, somewhere between 30 and 40 miles of driving, depending on the driving style. And that's because it's operating in this blended mode.
Okay. Yeah, I didn't know it was operating in the blended mode. So
yeah.
That's on the recharge, how long does it take? Say you're down to the 7% state of charge. How long does it take to get it? I guess you just let it run up to 100%?
Yeah, it's about 1.2 kilowatt hours or kilowatt charging. So it takes around 4 hours to go from zero to full.
And the PV array that's powering that, that's straight in. There's no battery backups or anything like that.
The PV, just to be totally clear, the right way to do PV is to be grid tied, and that's a completely grid tied array. So we don't want to give the impression that that PV array is there just to feed the cars. That PV array does about 30% of the peak of the power for all the entire Google campus. What wasn't shown there, you could see on that picture, I don't know, we can't go to the back to the picture now, but on the buildings that were kind of in the fringe of the picture, there was also PV on that. We have, I think it's 9 or 10 buildings are covered in PV, plus we have two solar car parts like the one that you could see there. So we had, it's a 1.6 megawatt peak system, which covers about 30% of our campus now. Our campus is still growing quite rapidly, so that percentage will dwindle over time.
You don't do net metering, you just do peaking then?
Net metering for our...
In other words, into the grid,
I think
peaking?
Because I don't think we're doing net metering because it's, you know, we don't have over 100% of our capacity available. So we're feeding the grid, but in reality, we're feeding the grid right back to ourselves because we're using more energy than that's putting out.
Okay. All right.
So.
Other questions?
Hi, Mark Fry from Nissan's Technology Planning Department in Farmington Hills, Michigan. I got two questions for you. A lot of the things you described, do you guys have a long-term roadmap with milestones that you guys have internally set for yourselves? And the second question is all the data you've collected, have you analyzed it for maybe improving the driver's ability to, you know, be more fuel efficient, like an eco driving type program? With all the data that you have, to say that you've driven well, and we've got this fuel efficiency. You could have been driving better than this and save more fuel, et cetera.
So the answer to both of those things is we're working on it. And the first part of the question, you know, it started out as a simple idea, let's do a plug-in hybrid demonstration project, and as you've seen, it's grown into this much broader initiative. And yes, as part of that, we have some internal goals about where we want to see this go and what kind of things we want to do. We're not ready to publicly declare what all of those things are, but one thing that we do want to do, and I mentioned it a little earlier, is, you know, we want to be a place where we can try out a lot of these new vehicles as they come out. So if you guys have some plug-in vehicles, whether plug-in hybrid or pure electric, come talk to us. We'd love to be sort of an alpha or beta test site for some of your cars, be able to show what you guys can do. I'm trying to remember what the second part of the question was. Oh, driver behavior. Yeah, so what we kind of wanted to make sure, we wanted to make this so that it wasn't something where we were teaching the drivers how to drive. We wanted this to be a real world situation. We've done that for a while, and we've learned, one thing we learned is it's real world for our world, but it's not real world representative of the average U.S. driver. So that's what we're doing, this test that we've been working day and night on getting all set up right now. We hope to have results for that in a few months. And we have thought about, you know, kind of now closing that feedback loop back to the drivers and seeing if we can help people learn how to drive better. So we're really looking forward to doing a lot of experiments with this fleet and with the data collection system that we've built, and hope to, you know, learn a lot of new things. And we're just at the startup, and we've collected all this great data, and we didn't present some of the things that we've analyzed here, but we've just scratched the surface on analyzing the data. So we're hoping to really do a lot more. This started as what a so-called 20% project. Every Googler that was involved was, it was just their 20% time. And now we finally have a few full-time people like Adam and Rolf on board that can dedicate some time to this. So we're really looking forward to working more on this.
I think it's probably an important takeaway that we are not advocating PHEV conversions as the be-all, end-all. I mean, that was a starting point for us. And we're very much interested in what's going on in the industry. We would like to see OEM produce PHEVs. We're kind of expanding our horizon too. The PHEV conversions were the here and now technology, and it's what we're working with right now, but the roadmap is definitely to look much more broadly in the future.
Hi, Kay Maleski with the USDOE Clean Cities Program. And first of all, I just want to say congratulations. When I think of Google, I don't traditionally think of cars, but thank you for thinking outside the box and going after this. There's a, I think that there are a lot of really good practices that are happening there that companies can learn from. The gentleman from Nissan pretty much asked my question. I'm just really curious about what you're doing with all this data that you're collecting. You mentioned the OEMs and the utilities that you're working with. Are you looking primarily to share that information with them initially and then maybe make this more available to the public? For instance, the website that you showed, is that an internal website, or can average Joe get on Google.com and see what you're doing with this project? Because I think it's really valuable what you're doing, and getting that information out to the general masses, I think, would be interesting. So.
Well, I think that speaks to what Google itself, it's part of Google's sort of core technology is obviously information technology. And so while we're sort of in sort of raw data acquisition mode and we're slicing and dicing the data in a very preliminary fashion at this point, one of our goals is definitely to make the data that we have much more easily available, whether it's some sort of an API to the data that we have available through the website. We'd also like to provide ability for third-party plug-in vehicle owners to be able to upload data about their personal cars or their fleets or whatever, so we get additional information about what's really going on in the plug-in space. So you can expect more of that at some point in the future. It's just for right now it's sort of manpower or resources that are limiting some of that. And as to your question about this data being available, go to recharge.it.org and you can drill down into some of the data that we saw during Adam's presentation. All of our trip data is displayed. As Adam mentioned, we have some Ford Escape plugins. That data is not available on the website just yet, but hopefully in the coming weeks we'll have that up as well. And again, that's all going to be publicly available data.
That's exciting. We have time for one more question.
Hi, I have a question about that data. What you show right now on the website, and you displayed it before, you show one figure for the miles per gallon that you've achieved over the life cycle of your driving experience with that particular vehicle. You also show the watt hours per mile. Now, that too is a figure that represents the total watt hours consumed per mile over all the miles driven for the vehicle. Can you extrapolate from that, just trying to get to try to measure the total emissions generated from that vehicle on a per mile basis? Are we to take the miles per gallon figure and add the watt hours per mile? Does that make sense?
Yeah. So, hot mic again. That was a very important point that I, before we went public with this, I kind of hammered on that we have to show both the gas usage and the electricity usage. A lot of people are going around talking about 150 mile per gallon hybrids and not even mentioning the fact that, they're plug-in hybrids and there's electricity too. Now, there's two ways to display that. One is to try to calculate some sort of mile per gallon equivalency, MPGE, and another is to just show the two things, the miles per gallon and the watt hours per mile. Given that virtually none of our electricity is created from oil in the United States, we felt that the right way to do that was to show both of those things. And then we actually have a CO2 calculator on there There's a bunch of, go to recharge.org and check out. There's a bunch of information on our website and FAQ that explains how we do all of our CO2 calculations and everything. But that CO2 number includes all of that. So it includes the power mix for California, and then we have a calculator. You can go to a different part of the state or different part of the country, pick a different state, and you can calculate what the CO2 impact would be if you were in a different state or different area of the country. And it's a very important point. You always have to show, if you're powered by two sources, you always have to show the fact that you're using energy from both of those sources and count the full impact from both of those sources.
Sure. I learned a new term today. It's Googlers. I would assume that would be those of us who Google, but apparently it's those of you who work for Google. So I learned something new today. I want to congratulate you again. Let Adam know that we were sorry he couldn't come, but you guys did a fabulous job. And we want you to come back to our conference in Florida next year and update us on what else you've added to your program and what the results are, because this is very important to this industry, what you do. Thanks to Adam, thanks to Alec, thanks to Rolf, and for those of you who came, let's give them a warm applause.
For more Press Pass coverage of all major automotive events, visit theautochannel.com, the Internet's most complete and comprehensive automotive information resource.